Good afternoon. It is, thank you very much for the introduction, and it is an absolute honor to be here in Brooklyn. And not just because I truly love this borough, but also it's a good chance to also just to come home. One thing about that we've had with the process of this tour, was we've been doing a lot of traveling and going to different places and you know, churches, libraries, community centers, schools all over the country, talking about the book and some of the issues that the book talks about. And as I was laughing with my wife and saying, as much as I enjoy Kansas City and Des Moines and places like that, it's good coming home, and it's good getting back to New York. And the fact that you all are here in the middle of a Saturday afternoon says a lot, and I'm just very thankful. I see a lot of, you know, a lot of friends and family here, so I'm just very appreciative and very thankful that you all made the time to come out here today. And you know, the process of this book has been fascinating for me, because when you put something like that out, you always have kind of a hope of what the book can drive. You have a hope of the larger conversation that you hope that the book could inspire. And I've been so humbled and blessed to see that the exact intention of what we'd hope to do with this book has come to fruition. I've been so humbled by the fact that I was talking with a group of students out in St. Louis last week, and they asked a question. They said, so what has been the coolest thing about the book tour? And they said, you know, has it been being on Oprah or being on Colbert or meeting these people? And I said, you know what, honestly, while that's been interesting and fun and all, not taking anything away from it, the coolest thing about this experience for me thus far have been the thousands of letters from teachers and parents and students that we've received in connection with this book, and how they're using the book and what they've taken from the book. I think about a letter from a 16-year-old in Baltimore that I got, in which he said, he thanked me for writing it, because he says, when you are, he said this was the first book that he's ever read cover to cover. And he said how for the first time in his life, when he read about these two lives, it forced him to think a little bit more about the type of man that he wanted to be for his family. Or I think about the mother who brought her son to an event. And the son was standing there, and the son was walking off to the side with him, and she asked the son to stand off to the side, and she pulled me to the side. And she said, I just wanted to pull you to the top for a second and just thank you, because she said, you know, sometimes I feel like my son is from a different planet. You know, I'll say something, and 15 minutes later, he'll do the exact opposite, as if we just didn't have this conversation. And she said, he saw you on an interview, and he came up to me, and he said, Ma, can you get that book for me? And she said she was shocked. He's never asked for a book before. And so she said she went out and bought a copy for her and got a copy for her son. And she said they've actually been reading the book together now. And at the end of every chapter, they sit there and discuss some of the lessons that they've gotten from this. Or the woman who now has become my friend, a woman named Phoebe from North Carolina, who every month will update me on the community service project that she's working on, just to show me that she wants to make a difference inside of her community and be a part of a larger solution. Things like that was my entire hope for this whole process. Because I never wanted people to just see this book as a book, say, wow, that's a cool story, and then throw it off to the side. I wanted this book to be a larger call to action. I wanted people to understand what are the consequences of these two stories, and understand that the book is about much more than just simply these two kids. But it's about our society. It's about our communities. And the impact of either when we get involved, or the impact of when we stay apathetic, and what ends up happening with these final consequences. So those are the kind of things that I've been so humbled about throughout this whole process. Those are the things that I've been so touched about, that I've been able to see and see people actually come to their own discoveries about what exactly this means and what the consequences of these two stories are. And it's amazing to me, because when I think about my own life, this process has been great for me too, and that's why I always tell people, I encourage people, if you aren't a writer, start writing. Even if you have no desire to publish your story, even if you have no desire for anyone else to read it with the exception of you, the act of actually sitting down and telling your story, even if it's just to yourself, is extraordinary. Because it also helps you to get a greater sense of appreciation for your life. And quite honestly, had it not been for me forcing myself to make a journey into the life of this other guy, I would have never been forced to take that same journey for myself. And it's been one of the most remarkable experiences of my life. When I was 3.5 years old, I watched my father pass away in front of me. And when I was 3.5 years old, I saw that as he had passed away, people had told me that he'd passed away, and I never really understood what exactly that meant. At 3.5 years old, people told me that he'd moved on, and I had no idea where he was supposed to have gone or when he was coming back. And then as I got older, I came to this very clear realization that the idea of him coming back was something that would never actually take place. And then as I got older and began to realize that, that uncertainty about what that meant turned into a lot of pain about what that meant. That pain turned into a sense of apathy, a sense of belligerence, and quite honestly, a sense of fear. Because when you learn a lesson like that at such a young age, and I'm a firm believer that any time a person loses a parent, it's extraordinarily difficult. Extraordinarily difficult at any age. And when it happens at a point when you're so young that you almost have to understand what that means as you're getting older, for whatever the reason happens to be, that pain has a way of compounding. And literally compounding to the point that before I was even a teenager, I find myself getting very lost and just with a real sense of confusion about who I was, about where I was going, about what I was supposed to do. And my mother had been trying. My mother is pretty aggressive and pretty creative with her punishments. And my mother is one of these people that is, you know, and I see so many parents out here, and you know, and I see the banks, so I know this will like them as well. I mean, these are people who will sacrifice anything for their children. But my mother also made it very clear that those sacrifices didn't come with no expectation as to what you're supposed to do and how you're supposed to perform for those sacrifices. You know, my mother always said, and I laugh now when she used to tell me, she said, you know, I never gave birth to you because I needed another friend. You know, she made it very clear that she was my parent. She made it very clear that she was my mother and what that meant. And so as I started acting out at a very young age, my mother started coming with all these different ideas and thoughts as to what she could do to straighten me out, what she could do to kind of set me back on the right path. And with every turn and every decision that she made, I found another way and another reason to show her that it wasn't working. So literally by the time I was 8, 9, and 10 years old, I was already on academic and disciplinary probation at my school. I was already involved in the juvenile justice system up in New York. By this point, we'd actually moved from Maryland, moved up to New York, so we were actually living in the Bronx with my grandparents. And my mother even at that point was working 3 different jobs because she said, I want to send them to another school across town. But one thing that happened with me when I went to the school across town, she actually literally, I mean, what would happen was my mother would actually wake us up in the morning. And after she'd wake us up in the morning, she would then go to her first job. And then my grandparents would either take us to the bus stop or take us off to the train and take us off to school. My grandparents would then come get us after school. And then by the time my mother came back home from her last job, we were basically already asleep. So then she would come in and kiss us goodnight and go to bed and then start her day like that the whole time. And one thing she realized, even as she sent me to the school across town, I started feeling even more alienated. Because very quickly, as I went to this school across town, this private school across town, I became almost too poor for the kids that I was going to school with, but became too rich for now for the kids in my neighborhood who didn't know why I had to leave them and go to school across town. So my behavior just began to get worse and worse and worse, to the point that eventually I started picking and choosing which days I needed to go to school, to the point that with every single instruction that I got, my consistent default reaction was almost this healthy sense of skepticism and cynicism. And my mother had been talking about this idea about sending me away to another school. This time she's like, I'm just gonna send you to military school. And I'd look at her and I'd say, okay, mommy, I know. All right, I'll work harder, I'll do better. And then when I was 9 years old, the threats continued and she started actually handing me like brochures to show me she wasn't playing. And I'd look at these brochures that she handed me, I'd look and I'd just smile, I'd say, all right, mommy, I know, I'll work harder, I'll do better. And then when I was 10 and 11 and things just consistently got worse, and then finally by the time I was 12, she said to me, she's like, you know, I'm gonna send you to military school. And I said, all right, mommy, I know. We've talked about this for years. I'm gonna do better. And she looked at me and she said, no, I'm gonna send you next week. And then she's had me go to my room and start packing my stuff up. And she wasn't playing. So she then starts getting me ready to send me off to this school that she thought was this brilliant idea. And this school was in a place called Wayne, Pennsylvania. And Wayne, Pennsylvania is kind of in the middle of nowhere, right? If you take a big forest and you do a big cutout of the forest and drop some buildings in the middle, that then is basically my new home, this place. And up until that point in my life, I know cities, right? I know buildings, I know lights, I know barking dogs, I know cities. I don't know anything about this forest and this school. But she decides this was a really good idea to send me off to this place. And when I first got to this school, I mean, I absolutely hated it. Literally in the first 5 days, I had already run away 4 times from the school. I mean, every time they would turn their backs, I was climbing the gates and running outside of the gates just to try to get out of there. And I kept on looking for this train station in the middle of the woods. I kept on trying to find this train station. After the last time I ran away, my squad leader actually came into my room and actually handed me a map to the train station because he was sick of me getting lost, trying to run through the woods, trying to find this train station. True story, no, seriously. And then I actually woke myself up, set my alarm late that night, and I knew I was gonna have this whole great escape. So I set my alarm for 11:30, the alarm goes off, I quickly shut it off. I say peace to my roommate, give him a pound, I grab a little bag that had like a bag and a change of clothes and a granola bar and a flashlight. And then I started heading off to the woods to find where this train station was with my little map. And so I'm running out through the woods and, you know, the map is saying, okay, you're gonna take 10 paces and you'll see a big tree and make a left. And so I'm going my 10 paces throughout the woods looking for a big tree, and I realize I'm in the middle of the forest. There are nothing but big trees all around me, right? But I keep following this map and going to these big trees and making a left, and you're gonna go 30 paces and you'll see a big rock and you make a right, and I do that. And I'm just going deeper and deeper and deeper into the woods. And then finally, as I started going deeper into the woods, now I'm scared to death. Because I'm 12 years old, I'm from the city, and now I'm hearing like leaves rustling and wild animals and whatever else was chasing me out there that night. And eventually I just sit down and I start crying, because there's nothing I wanted more at that point than just to go home. There's nothing I wanted more at that point for people just to leave me alone and let me be and stop bothering me. And as I'm sitting there crying, I started hearing leaves rustling, and I thought it was just gorillas or elephants or whatever else was chasing me in the woods that night. And then I start hearing laughter. So I turn around, and it was my entire chain of command who followed me out. The map was fake. The map took me to the middle of the woods. They just wanted to see how bad I wanted to go home that night. And that night they got their answer that I'm serious, I want to go home. And so they brought me back to campus, and we weren't allowed to have any outside communication. No phone calls, television, radio, nothing. But they said, if we don't make one exception, we're going to lose him. And so they said, Moore, you've got 5 minutes to make a phone call. Call whoever you want, but you've got 5 minutes. And I call the only number that I knew, which is my mom. So I call my mom, and she's not expecting to hear from me for about, you know, 8 weeks, and now here it is on day 5 at 4 o'clock in the morning, 1 o'clock in the morning, she gets a phone call. So I'm like, mommy, listen, you know, this has been a great experiment and all, but I'm really ready to come home. I've enjoyed this place a lot, but, you know, let me come back. You know, I'll go to school more often. I'll clean your room, my room. I'll do whatever you want. Just let me come home. And I'm begging for her to let me back. And she stops me. And she says, too many people have sacrificed in order for you to be there. And too many people are rooting for you. And your father's looking down at you and he's proud of you, and everybody just wants you to give it a shot. And at the end of it, she said something where she said, you know, and you've got to understand, it isn't all about you. It's not all about you. And at the end of the 5 minutes, the phone call ended, and I, quite honestly, I got off the phone and I was completely unmoved. I went to bed that night just as mad as I went the night before. I woke up the next morning just as angry as I woke up the morning before. But eventually I began to understand what she was talking about. Eventually I began to understand what she was talking about when she said things about accountability and responsibility and the idea that it wasn't all about me. And it started to make sense. And I realized throughout that process and throughout that time was that it wasn't so much about taking me from one environment and putting me into another environment. Because one thing I'll go into a little later on is actually I think that's actually the wrong answer in the way we deal with education inside this country. But more importantly, what happened was It was a psychological change. It was changing and altering the way that you think about the world and about your role in it. And so by the end of that first year, I was actually doing okay academically, and I was allowed to play sports because I wasn't on probation anymore, and I was enjoying that, and they gave me some ranks, so now I was proud of myself, so I was walking around my shoulders back because I was in charge of people now. And we'd moved back down to Maryland, and my mom said, you know, you can go back to school in Baltimore. You can go to school in Baltimore if you want. And I said, actually, if it's okay, I'd like to sit tight. And I ended up actually finishing high school there, joining the Army, going on to community college, and then from there going on to Johns Hopkins. And it was while I was at Johns Hopkins that the idea and the story behind this book was really better understood. Because when I was a senior at Johns Hopkins, the Baltimore Sun had just written a piece on my life, my childhood, because I just received the Rhodes Scholarship. And they basically were saying that, you know, here is a local kid who had some issues coming up. But through a lot of help and a lot of support and a lot of intervention, I just received this award. And the same time, they were writing a series on four guys who robbed a jewelry store. And two guys walked into the jewelry store, and as soon as they walked into the store, they pulled guns out of their shirts and they got everybody on the ground, everybody who was working there, everybody who was shopping there. And then soon after, two guys with mallets then walked into the jewelry store. And one guy with a gun and one guy with a mallet went to the left, and one guy with a gun and one guy with a mallet went to the right. And the ones with the guns were keeping everybody on the ground, while the ones with the mallets were then walking around smashing out jewelry cases and taking out watches and rings and necklaces. And they met at the back of the store with a little over $400,000 worth of jewelry, and one of them yelled, "Let's go," and then all four then ran out of the center of the store. And one of the people that was inside the store that day was an off-duty police officer who was moonlighting as a security guard. And that off-duty police officer was a 13-year veteran of the Baltimore Police Force. He was a three-time recipient of Police Officer of the Year. He was a father of five who just had triplets. And the reason he was working that day was because he needed to make extra money for his family. And he got up off the ground and he drew his weapon and he ran outside to the adjacent parking lot to see if he could stop him from getting away. And as he was outside in the parking lot, he was kneeling next to cars and kneeling next to vehicles to see if he could figure out where they were. And he didn't realize that one of the vehicles that he was kneeling next to was one of the vehicles that the guys were in. And then a window rolled down, and then three shots were taken at point blank range. And he was killed instantly. And there was a 12-day national manhunt that took place looking for these four guys. At the end of those 12 days, all four guys were caught. 11 years ago to this day, all four of those guys were caught. 11 years ago to this day. And one thing I realized, and one thing I found out as the manhunt ended, and as they caught the last two of the four guys, was one of the people that they caught was a guy named Wes Moore. And the way I actually first learned about Wes, I was actually studying abroad in South Africa. And my mother's a pretty even-paced voice, and then I get a phone call from her, and her voice almost sounds a bit frantic, and I'm like, "Mommy, what's going on?" And she says, "No," she said, "I just gotta tell you," she said, there are wanted posters all over your neighborhood." And I'm thinking to myself, and at that time, you know, I'm living back in Baltimore, and in fact, living over in West Baltimore, and quite honestly, I mean, I don't know if many people here know Baltimore, but it's a tragic and unfortunate fact that unfortunately for far too many people in Baltimore, far too many neighborhoods in Baltimore, wanted posters are not that unusual. And so I'm still thinking, so what's, okay, I understand that. And then she's like, "Well, a police officer was murdered." And I'm thinking to myself, this is tragic, but I'm still not sure why this justifies a long distance phone call. And that's when she said to me that the signs all over your neighborhood say that the police are looking for Wes Moore. And the more I learned about Wes, the more I realized how much more we had in common than just our names. I realized the fact that in addition to that we were both living in the same neighborhood. In fact, at that point, literally living blocks away from each other. I realized the fact that we both grew up in single parent households, realized the fact that we both had academic and disciplinary troubles growing up. And I knew there were questions that I wanted to ask. I knew there were things that I wanted to have answers to, but I knew that Wes was the only one that could answer them. So one day I just decided to write him. I decided to write him a note. I had no idea if he'd write back, And quite honestly, in many ways, it didn't matter because I knew I couldn't control what he does. But I wrote him a note. And then a month later, I received a letter from Jessup Correctional Institution from Westmore. And if the letter was written in crayon, as almost as if he wrote it with his whole hand and it didn't make any sense, I'd almost feel like I would get the answer that I was looking for. I'd almost feel like I would look at that letter and say, you know what, I get it. I understand it. The problem is that it wasn't. The problem is, to this day, it is still one of the most interesting and articulate and introspective letters that I've ever received. Because the first thing he wrote to me was, he first thanked me for writing him, because he says, when you're in prison, you think that the whole world doesn't think you even exist anymore. And then he proceeded to answer all the questions that I laid out to him. Questions about his family, questions about his older brother, who was actually the trigger man that day. Questions about his children, because I knew he had kids because of the articles that I read. Questions about Baltimore. And that one letter eventually turned into dozens of letters between us. Those dozens of letters turned into dozens of visits. And now I've known Wes for over 7 years. And when the first idea of this book even came about, and I'm so happy to see Linda, my book agent here, because when the first idea of this book even came about, I remember I was speaking with a mutual friend of ours, a woman named Terry. I don't know if y'all know Terry Williams. She's up in Harlem. She's not just a public relations guru, but an author as well. And I was speaking to her about this story because I'd known Wes for years before the idea of a book came about. And Terry said, you know what? I really want you to talk to Linda about this, because I think there's a bigger story here to be understood. I think there's a bigger truth to be understood. And my first reaction was, you know what? I'm just not that interested. Because quite honestly, I felt like I didn't have time to do that story. I didn't feel like I didn't have time to, I didn't want to dig that deeply into Wes's life or my own life, because I knew what kind of undertaking it would be. And then there were two main real factors that pushed, that kept gnawing to say, you know what, there is a bigger truth to be understood here. The first thing was, I thought of a quote by a gentleman named Edmund Burke. And Edmund Burke said, all it takes for evil to triumph is for good people to do nothing. And then I thought about something that Wes told me when I talked to Wes about it. He said, listen, I've wasted every opportunity I've ever had in life. And I'm going to die in here. So if you can do something that can help people better understand the consequences for their decisions, and also do something to help people understand the neighborhoods that these decisions are being made in, then I think you should do it. And those then became the fire of this entire process, this entire journey that we went on. And what's been amazing to me is I've learned so much, again, not just about Wes, but about myself throughout this whole process. But there are a few major takeaways that I've really enjoyed learning about, not just throughout the process of actually writing the book, but then seeing the reactions around as we've gone through this process. That people say, they're like, so what was the one thing? What was that one thing that makes a child go one way, or one thing that makes a child go another thing? And my answer is, you know what? There is no one thing. There is no one thing. Raising kids is extraordinarily complicated. And when you have to raise kids in some of the most precarious communities, under the most precarious circumstances that we have in this country, it makes it that much more complicated. I get that. But there are a couple things that I know. I know that expectations matter. When I was talking to Wes, we were talking about Baltimore, and I asked him, I said, so do you think that we're products of our environment? And he looked back at me and he said, actually, I think we're products of our expectations. And as soon as he said it hit me, and I thought to myself, you know what, he's absolutely right. And not just the expectations that we have of ourselves, but the expectations that other people have of us, because the expectations we have from ourselves are born from somewhere else. Each and every one of us can look at our own lives and look at the things that we hope to be, the things that we became, the things that we will become, and we know that that seed was planted by the hands, by the words, by the actions of other people around us. I know that every single step, every single journey I have taken has been guided. There is nothing that I've done on my own or by myself. Every single, you know, it's interesting when you hear the bio and they're like, you know, Wes Moore is a Rhodes Scholar, he's a White House Fellow, he's this, he's that. I can tell you the person, the moment in my life where that seed was planted. It wasn't because I planted it myself. It's because other people saw something that, quite honestly, I didn't even see it myself at the time. Expectations matter. I know the role of family matters. And might not necessarily be your birth family, might not necessarily be the ones that have the same blood running through you, but the people who step up in your life that are just like family. The people who take you in as if you're family, even if there is no blood relation. The people who are always there for you when you need that help and you need that support. And I know the role of education matters. And education, not just for these young boys, but quite honestly, let's take it back a generation. Let's talk about the role of education in the two mothers. Because one thing people say when they look, they say, well, this is probably the case of one bad mother and one good mother. Well, I can tell you right now, that's not the case in this story. You have two mothers who both care deeply and seriously about their children. To this day, still care deeply about their children. Wes's mother was the first one in her family to go to college. She graduated from Baltimore City Community College. She later on was accepted to Johns Hopkins University. She's a student at Johns Hopkins University, and then the Pell Grants are cut. And she can no longer afford to go to school. Now, I can't help but think how her life could have been different had she had the chance to finish her education. Not simply because of the piece of paper, not simply because of the diploma that she had, but quite honestly, is what comes with that diploma. It's the idea that your networks change, your friendships change, your connections change. Over 70% of jobs in this country are not found by typical resumes and classifieds. They're not found by monster.com. They're found because someone gives you a phone call and says, hey, I heard about you from a mutual friend, and I'd like to talk to you about this. Or, you know what, I call a friend and say, I'm thinking about getting into the field of engineering. Do you know anybody who's an engineer? And my friend says, yeah, I know two engineers. Let me introduce you to both of them. I can tell you right now, and I'm sure if I did a quick straw poll of everybody in the audience, if you think about the job that you have now or a recent job that you've had, how many were influenced by other people, not by traditional means? And I can tell you right now, I'd be the first one to raise my hand. Pretty much every single job I've ever had, that's been the case. Education matters. If you think about every single issue that we fight in this country right now, all the top issues, and this is actually one of the things that frustrates me, is when I hear people talk about what are the biggest issues that our country faces, and I don't hear the word education come out of their mouth, I think, then you know what, we've got this wrong. Whether we're talking about energy independence, whether you're talking about national security, whether you're talking about jobs, whether you're talking about taxes, education is at the heart of each and every one of those issues. You can't talk about alternative energy policy in this country without understanding the fact that both solar and wind energy were developed inside of this country, but we now have become net importers of solar and wind technologies. A technology that was born in this country, we now pay other people to develop for us. You can't talk about the idea about national security, and again, I'm a veteran, and I'm a very proud veteran, but I honestly consider one of the largest national security threats that we have in this country the fact that only 30% of people in this country between the ages of 18 and 23 even qualify for military service. You can't talk about this idea of jobs, and what that means without understanding education. Because the fact is, when you look at the past 24 months, this economic tsunami that's been hit, people with college degrees, the unemployment rate for them has stayed relatively flat. The reason we've gone from 5% nationally to 10% nationally is for people without college and high school degrees. You cannot talk about the idea about taxes in this country without understanding that we're talking about a shell game. The tax system in this country has to be addressed. I understand that. People in the upper echelon need to pay more. I understand that. But the fact is, the best way to address taxes in this country is to make sure we have more people who are part of a tax-paying base. That's the way we address this issue. It's at the core and the heart of everything that we do. And if you see in the process of the story these two kids, it's at the core and the heart of everything that happened within the lives of these two kids. The importance of intervention, the importance of being there, the importance of providing a quality education to all kids, regardless of their zip code, regardless of their parental history, is what this country is all about. It's what this nation thrives on. It's what makes us who we are. And that, after going through this process, is one thing that I know. That's one thing I know. I'm sorry, sir. Can I borrow your book real quick? Thank you so much. What's your name? Cameron. Cameron? Thank you so much, Cameron. I appreciate it. He's letting me borrow this book. It's a good book, I heard. I want to read a small part of this book. One thing I heard that authors do at book signings is read a part of their book. So being a first-time author, I feel like I need to get busy and get cranking on it. But I wanted to read just a small part, and then actually have something else special that I'd like to do for everyone here as well. And after that, I'll to answer questions. But there's a small part of the book that I think really ties in to exactly what we're talking about today, and the urgency and the importance of addressing these issues. And it says, when we're young, it sometimes seems as if the world doesn't exist outside our city, our block, our house, our room. We make decisions based on what we see in that limited world and follow the only models available. The most important thing that happened to me was not being physically transported. The moves from Baltimore to the Bronx to Valley Forge didn't change my way of thinking. What changed was that I found myself surrounded by people, starting with my mom, grandparents, uncles, and aunts, and leading to a string of wonderful role models and mentors who kept pushing me to see more than what was directly in front of me, to see the boundless possibilities of the wider world and the unexplored possibilities within myself. People who taught me that no accident of birth, not being black or relatively poor, being from Baltimore or the Bronx or fatherless, would ever define me or limit me. In other words, they helped me to discover what it means to be free. As I wrote at the outset of this book, the chilling truth is that Wes's story could have been mine. The tragedy is that my story could have been his. My only wish, and I know Wes feels the same, is that the boys and girls who come after us will know this same freedom. It's up to us, all of us, to make a way for them. Thank you so much.